We are back with Star May. It's good to have her on. That's a great name.
Thank you.
Star May.
Like, who knew?
Is that really your name?
It is.
Not just your restaurant chef name.
No, Star it's May. Not. It's actually Starlet.
Starlet May. I like that. Yeah. That's a great name. Chef at Anzi Blue is with us. You may have seen her recently. I guess, were you on Talk of the Town recently?
Hello?
Yeah. And she's an author. We're taking phone calls, talking about dishes and stuff. Before we get to our first phone call, I wanted to say you're a restaurant also known for coffees and the like, and you've kind of jumped on this CBD wagon, which I think of late has tapered off a bit. There was a real craze for a while. It's certainly still out there, and right. people go with it, but talk a bit about infusing some of, I don't know, is it just the coffees or is it foods
as well?
Yeah, it's
just, well, Anzi Blue actually started out as a CBD store and grew quickly into that restaurant. That explains it for me.
Then. I didn't know that.
Yeah, right. So we do it in all of our beverages. You can get it in cocktails, you can get it in mocktails, you can get it in a regular Coke. I tell people, sometimes I put it in water.
Yeah.
So sometimes I just need to like.
What do you find
decompress.
That the CBD, and again, CBD, which is a cannabis derivative, is completely legal. It's not getting you high.
No.
But a lot of people think that maybe it can bring, some say, a calming factor.
Yeah.
Some. What do you think?
I definitely think so. I work at a high pressure job, and sometimes the kitchen gets to be a lot, and I need to just woosah. So yeah. I'm like, hey, can you squeeze me a bit in there? And then
it relaxes me just
a little bit. So for us to be able to get through what we need to.
Are there different types? Is it one type of CBD that you'll put into these coffees, or can people select different varieties?
Yeah, they can select different varieties and flavors. Like we have mint and blackberry.
Really?
Yeah.
Okay. Another thing that's interesting. I've seen they've started infusing it in all kinds of things.
Yeah.
In beer even and stuff like that.
Water.
Water. Mm-hmm. For different kind of waters.
Yeah.
Let's take a call from James. James, good morning. Hi, James.
Good morning, Nick.
Good morning.
Thank you for your service, Star. I got a wonderful trick that I learned from my grandfather that was part Indian.
All right, what we got?
What's that?
All right, what you do is you take your iron skillet, get it screaming hot.
Uh-huh.
You mix up your cornbread batter the best you got. Take pepper jack cheese and crawfish and shrimp, and you pre-cook them, mix it in, and when you pour your batter in, you hit it with a little sugar right around the edge as that pan's screaming hot, that skillet.
Yeah.
Boy, it'll sear the outside of that cornbread, and you're talking about good.
So you just pick that, and all the crawfish and everything then are baked into the cornbread.
Yes, sir.
Wow, that sounds awesome.
James, that sounds good. You're going to make me one.
Yeah. Now, see, what James is into, or his grandfather was, that's fusion, isn't it? I mean, he fused a bunch together. And he's right. I'm glad he brought up just the whole idea of cast iron skillet.
Oh, yeah.
All right, that's another thing. Until I moved here, I had no idea. You know, we had Teflon pans and all this kind of stuff with copper.
Nonstick.
And then my wife's mother had one that she used. It's kind of like a wok.
Yeah.
The longer you use a cast iron pan, right, you believe it gets seasoned and better. You buy a new one, it looks great, but that's not really
it's
all that
not
good.
Not gonna cook it, right.
The bottom of this pan feels like velvet. And what is it about cast iron? I mean, do you use, I guess, some dishes cast iron that you'll cook in?
Yeah, it's... Cast iron is like a heat controlled. Once it gets to that temperature, it's there.
So you're not worried, okay, so you know where it's going to be.
If it's going to drop the temperature down and change the whatever I'm cooking in it.
It holds it.
Yeah, it holds that temperature. I tell people I have a little Dutch oven.
What?
Dutch oven. It's a cast iron pot, basically.
Oh, yeah, I've seen you, right?
Yeah, and it makes the best things.
It does, and I don't understand. My neighbor once, we had the campfire going through the cast iron thing. He threw some blackberries and Bisquick in there. I'm like, whatever, Jimmy, that's going to be awful. And then we let it cook there for a while, and we pulled off the top, and it tasted with the same ingredients, different than it would have if we cooked in the oven.
Yeah.
Why? It's just... Again, the heat, and it was crunchy. It was perfect.
Perfect. Get a nice crunchy outside. It's the way it holds it. I tell people, for me, anytime that I can cook outside, it totally changes the food.
So cooking outside would you use charcoal?
Yeah, I could go over wood. Yeah, all of that. I use all of that. Sometimes I just like, I'll go get my little turkey fryer. I might fry fish outside.
Yeah.
Because it gives it a whole different crisp.
Yep.
It's something about the outside air and the way it goes through the food. I just,
Yeah.
It's a whole different situation.
Are you going to do anything special for 4th of July?
No, we're actually close to 4th of July. Close.
What about you at home?
Ooh, me, my son is actually, he's going to barbecue.
Oh, okay. But, I mean, I'd feel a lot of pressure cooking for you.
Well, you know,
okay,
most
because you're
going to
be
do.
Like, yeah, well, I mean, around any accomplished chef who makes these incredibly beautiful dishes and look delicious, I'd feel pressure. Because I'm like, oh, gosh. And she's going to be nice, and she's going to say it's okay. Right. But
not tell people I eat anything. You know my favorite thing to eat? A peanut butter and jelly sandwich.
Really? A peanut butter and jelly?
Peanut butter jelly time.
That's, what kind of jelly?
Grape.
Grape jelly?
Smuckers.
Crunchy or smooth?
Smooth.
On white bread. Yeah. By the way, I was just saying, as you mentioned that, then we got to mention this recipe that we were looking at right off the bat. All right. So you.
Okay. Yeah.
You talked about peanut butter and jelly sandwich. This is my favorite peanut butter. I wish we could show this picture of it, but I don't know. Maybe it'll be tight enough just on me on this one. But this recipe right here. I don't know if you take that camera one. There we go. There we go. Okay. It's hard to see, but the one on my right hand here. What is that?
That is the king. It is a peanut butter, bacon, and banana sandwich.
That sounds like something Elvis might almost like.
That is his sandwich.
Okay,
that is right. Elvis's sandwich
well,
that he would eat at lunchtime.
Peanut butter and banana. Okay, so, all right. Because at first I'm like, okay, peanut butter and banana and bacon.
Yeah.
Okay, go on.
Have salt.
What else do you do then?
Okay, so then we dip it in a beignet batter. And then I throw it in the deep fryer and get it crunchy on the outside. Then I cut them open, let you see how beautiful it is.
And then
I throw some blueberry compote
that just
on the top.
Sounds incredibly decadent.
It's very good.
All right, so the whole idea, and you hit it there, the salt, you needed something salty to go with it. So it's not. And it's
when you deep fry it.
Okay, and you deep fry it.
Yeah.
Which is,
So it's like pow, pow, pow.
I know, deep frying's great, but gosh, what about people that have high cholesterol?
I would advise not to eat that.
Okay. I mean, now I used to have a friend, Ed Rice, would come on the show. He's famous for his country hams, and I'd say the same thing. What about you? He goes, Nick, just take an extra cholesterol pill or a blood pressure pill or whatever it is. Now, you can splurge every once in a while with something like that.
Yeah, I tell people that's a cheat day.
Yeah, right. There you go.
And, yeah,
and that would
situation.
Be worth it.
Yeah.
And the idea of salt, when you hear chefs talk about flavor and what really drives flavor, the two things that are behind most flavors in foods that human palate loves are salt and fat. Mm-hmm. Is that what you find?
I find that,
sugars maybe to agree, but salt and fat are the two biggies.
Mm-hmm. Those are the biggest. That's what people really are drawn to.
Yeah.
And with that, you get both of that.
Okay, but you do have, like, for instance, there's a recipe in here where you make greens.
Yeah.
Okay, and that's a vegetarian green, so you're not throwing...
It's a vegan green.
A vegan green. Okay, it's a vegan green.
Yeah, go deeper.
So there's no bacon fat, no ham or anything like that,
mm-mm.
And it gives it flavor.
Yeah.
All right.
All
so
the way
what
deep
do you,
down.
You season it typically then with, I saw you put a little liquid smoke in there.
Yeah.
But it's mostly like things like garlic, onion,
mm-hmm.
salt.
Yeah, salt and pepper. And I use a line of seasonings at Anzi Blue that are not area things. So I brought it with me when I came from the Gulf Coast, and it's Paul Prideaux's line of seasonings.
They're so good.
They're so great. Yeah, so we do use quite a bit of that. Bringing a little.
Do you have a preference for what kind of greens you like? You mix them, are you a turnip green, mustard green? Do you ever try poke salad?
I do like dried poke. What do you know about that?
Yes! How about these apples? All right, so we got these things growing on the side of our driveway, and my wife's like, well, you know, that's poke salad, Nick, and they're small ones. I go, really? So I go, yeah, you can eat those. I'm going to do it. So I went out, and I cut all this poke salad down off at the back. I checked with, you know, my sister-in-law, and I went online. You don't want to eat it fresh. You're supposed to boil it out because it can be a little toxic in the leaves, which makes me wonder why the heck we eat this stuff anyway. But I boiled it three times, changing the water, got it down, cooked it up, and threw it in eggs, and it was good. So... How about them apples? What do you think about that? You pick poke salad?
Of course. I grew up in a small area.
It's kind
area,
of a strong flavor. How often will you cook it and drain it? I mean, what do you
probably
do?
About three or four times. And I give it a good rinse with baking soda.
Oh.
I wash them with baking soda.
Okay.
Clean the leaves.
Now, by then,
really
they're
good.
Kind of cooked down by that. And then what will you do? Just like any other green, do you, they were suggesting you put it with scrambled eggs or what?
Yeah, I use it kind of like spinach.
Okay.
I use it in the same kind of applications as I would spinach.
Okay, but would you eat it like you would a green, like turnip green or a mustard green?
It's kind of bitter. It's a great mixing green, though. Like, you can mix it with other greens to bring out its flavor. Like, I like mixing it with collards.
Yep, and you're exactly right. It has a little bit of a bitter. It loses some of that the more you boil it, I think. But it does. And the other thing about boiling greens, I always said, well, the thing that gets me about boiling greens, they boil them too much, and, it comes out looking like seaweed, maybe, whatever. But, people love them. And all the vitamins get cooked into the water.
I steam mine.
Oh, smart. But then what did you say about the sauce or the broth or whatever in the South?
Yeah, in the South, it's all about the pot liquor.
Okay, what do you do with the pot liquor?
They usually eat it by itself in a bowl with some cornbread. So it's like cornbread and pot liquor. That's like how I grew up. That's my granddad's favorite way to do it.
So you're dipping the cornbread into the pot liquor, which came from cooking your greens in with some meat.
That's like a soup.
Yeah. That's exactly what it is.
Yeah, it turns into a soup
now.
And
nothing goes to waste, and that's where a lot of the nutrition ended up.
Yep.
God, that sounds good. All right, we'll take a break. I'm getting really hungry. All I have in my desk are some power bars and a piece of jerky.
You gotta do better, Nick.
But it's in the newsroom. I can't have fried peanut butter sandwiches
now. But you had a friend now. I could bring it to you.
I do. Stop it, you. You do Grubhub?
Yes, I do.
Okay, we'll take a break. When we come back, Mary and others who are on hold, stay there. We'll get to your calls. If you want to share a recipe with us or have a question for the chef, we'll continue right after this.